Hello, everybody, and welcome to Whispers on AM 1600, WKKX, the Valley's Watchdog, and UPRN, the UFO Paranormal Radio Network. It is 6:11 p.m., 58 degrees down here in downtown Wheeling. It is, I think it's a nice night out. The lovely Lola Miller tonight will be played by Biff Leonard. No?
Doesn't work as good, buddy.
Nah. Lola's out sick tonight. I think we're all getting a little that way, but Lola needs her break. So send your love and best wishes out to that girl. I'm Jordan Klein here with Nick Queen and Brother Biff. Give us a call, 304-214-1600. If you're out of the area, 1-866-514-1600. Nick, you want to say anything?
It's going to be a great night.
Oh, I'm excited.
Great night.
I'm excited. Let's get right to our guests. We actually do have them on the phone. From Egypt Valley Paranormal, we have Miss Joni and Mr. Mike. Are you there?
Yes.
Yeah, hi, guys.
Hi, how you guys doing?
Doing well.
No complaints.
No, we are really excited because there's so many questions. The host of the last show that was on was so intrigued that he had us on to talk about what we were going to talk about with you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, I mean, this is. Do you get that a lot? Do you get people just intrigued on the area that you cover?
No, not really.
Well, really?
She still lives out by there, so everybody pretty much.
Yeah, we're
knows.
All used to it out here, I guess.
And I live. I'm in Moundsville, West Virginia now, so yeah, I get a lot of questions.
Mm-hmm.
About the tales of Egypt Valley.
No. Okay, we got a lot of people that are out of the area. Okay, mm-hmm. That really have no clue what Egypt Valley is. Egypt Valley, what county is that?
Belmont.
It's in Belmont County? Okay,
mm-hmm.
Well, it's Belmont County, Ohio, and it's, from an outsider's point of view, it's a place that's always been, like, how do I want to say it?
Legendary.
Legendary with satanic rituals, cults, sacrifices, ghost stories. I mean, this is like the place to go if you want to die.
Well, actually, it's an Ohio State Wildlife Preserve now. You know? Yeah, we grew up listening to that. I mean, that's been since I was a kid. Actually, I grew up in Egypt Valley till I was 5.
Uh-huh.
Back when it was populated. I mean, there were farms. My grandfather had a gorgeous Victorian farm down there. My mom lived down there till my dad got out of the Army. I grew up there, and, you know, to me, it's just Egypt Valley. It's just like an old, like, homeside area. But as I got older, I did hear people from town, especially Barnesville, where I live now,
uh-huh.
With all this stuff about cults, and they saw this, and they said they saw it. I don't know. I never saw anything. They said they did. I've heard some pretty crazy stories.
Now, what kind of stories have you... You're not afraid at all to go there, you know?
No. I'm afraid of people. Because only because it was strip mined. Everything's gone. All the people that live there are gone. Which, you know, I do remember these houses and things. You go there now and it's just these thousands of square acres of just nothing.
Mm-hmm.
There's some cows. People put cows down there sometimes, and there is a quarry down there now. But because there are strange people that go down there, and that's what I am afraid of. I'm not afraid of anything else but that.
Strange people, what do you mean? I have to ask.
Oh, people, kids get down there and they smoke and they drink, which, you know, we did too.
Mm-hmm.
And they do crazy things. They go in and bust up the cemeteries, which is horrible.
Yeah,
and that happened again not too long ago.
Sacrifice people?
Sacrifice people? No.
None of that?
I know one of the stories I get a lot is that type of thing, animal sacrifice.
Uh-huh.
But what they don't realize is that people go down there and hunt.
Mm. Yeah.
And there have been animal skins found, but when I talk to other people about that do go down there a lot, they dry their skins. So, you know, you get both sides. So, but I have had people that tell me that they have seen things down there that are very strange.
Now, what kind of ghost stories do you get from there? Because it was populated, of course, you know, like you said.
It really was, yeah.
And it's probably got a long history, you know, for the area it's in. What kind of stories do you get?
Mostly we get the dogs, I think. Don't you think, Mike? Isn't that the most frequent one about the devil dogs?
The devil dogs, the red
and
eyes.
And the house.
And the red eyes, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Bigfoot.
Oh, you get Bigfoot, too?
Yeah. I do believe that's very possible down there, by the way. We had an experience down there about 3 years ago that we actually had a Bigfoot. I don't want to call him an expert because he doesn't like that. He's a researcher out of Minnesota on our show last week on Midwest Paratalk. And I had got a hold of him immediately when this happened. And he's probably going to be coming down here maybe next spring to check it out.
Now, is this where close to where you hear reports of something called the Grass Man?
Yeah. I don't know that they're similar. We're on the corner of what they call the Don Keating. I don't know if you know who he is. He's a researcher on it. Okay, good. He, you know, talks about the Sasquatch Triangle, which, you know, intakes, like, Salt Fork area and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And Egypt Valley sits on the corner of one of those, of that area, so, and as deserted as it is.
Yeah, so there's a chance. So, you know, I think the Grassman, from what he, you know, we talked to him about, you know, is like the Bigfoot, but they live in like a grass mound.
Yeah, it's a mound. Different thing. Yeah.
Now, you said devil dogs. Of course, whenever I think of devil dogs,
the Hounds of Baskerville.
Well, I think of the ones that chase people to their, you know, that till they die, because they've sinned, you know, or whatever. That's the stories I've always thought of with devil dogs. What exactly are you talking about when you say devil dogs?
There's legend of what they call the devil dogs, and apparently they're a wild pack of dogs, which, you know, of course that could be. And but what they say they do, particularly Circle Cemetery. Are you guys familiar with Egypt Valley cemeteries at all?
I'm
afraid to go there. I'm not going to lie.
Well, you know,
I'm just going to be up front.
We take you down.
Well, you see exactly what you just said. If I come down there, you're going to take me down.
We can have some people come in from Youngstown.
Yeah,
it's nothing to be afraid of. The Circle Cemetery is a little cemetery. They call it Circle because it's got a circular driveway around it. It's a small cemetery. It's down the road from Salem Cemetery, which is pretty good size and had a church at one time.
Mm-hmm.
But it sits back off the road. You have to go up, and sometimes you need a four-wheel drive to get up in there. And they say that those dogs guard that cemetery because I don't, Mike, is there even a standing tombstone there anymore?
No, the last time we were there, no, there wasn't.
Huh.
They
have just knocked them over and embedded them in the ground. And
now, people that are on that are either online listening or at your home listening, if you go to, and I'm going to give them your website address, Egypt Valley Paranormal Investigations.com, and you click on Egypt Valley Cemeteries. I'm looking right now at a picture of Circle Cemetery.
You can see.
Yeah, and it's.
It's unterrible.
Yeah, it's. I was looking at the trees in the background. It does have that eerie kind of presence to it. There, you know, some of them are.
That
know.
One does a little. I do get a little creeped out up there sometimes, just because. Well, the last time we were the last time we were down there, that's when me and another member took these people down from Youngstown. They wanted to see it, so we were there like 1 o'clock in the morning, and it was pretty. It was all right, and then it started getting a little creepy. I don't know if it's just the power of suggestion, or. The atmosphere or what, particularly there because it's so closed off from everything else, a circle.
Yeah.
Not that Salem isn't, but this is totally closed off. And there are, like, drop-offs all around you from where there are, like, the mine ponds from where they stripped. You have to be really careful, which is one, the only another thing to be afraid of down there. Watch where you're walking. But we don't know what it was. One of the members of Youngstown got a picture of it. It wasn't an orb. It was fluorescent, like a light yellowish green, and it was probably about 4 inches long, and we saw this with our eyes, and it wasn't a firefly, and we're chasing this thing all over that cemetery.
Really? So
it would fade out and come back, and it had a course. It wasn't like flying around just anywhere. It had a set course of where it was going, like it was flying.
Oh, wow.
And I don't know if that had anything to do with us getting a little creeped out or what, maybe. And then we heard some noises. But, I mean, you're in the middle of the woods, so you don't know.
Now you're saying like a firefly. Was it like the size of a firefly, or are we talking like a gigantic, like basketball-like shaped?
Oh, no. It was a rod. It was around 4 inches long. We were just trying to you know, go through and try to weed out everything that it possibly could be, and it didn't fit anything.
If it was flying.
It was flying, and it was probably a good 10 to 12 feet above us through the trees. We just watched it for like 20 minutes, and just, it was amazing.
Now, what kind of dates are we talking about with the Circle Cemetery, which is, you say, is Old Egypt Cemetery on your website? How old are we talking for this site?
1800s.
Okay.
Early 1800s.
Now, is this the oldest one in the area?
Well, one of the stones there that you can actually read as like laying, it's like lying against a tree. It was 1792.
Wow.
I mean, there's very few stones. There's, and like my sister said, there's one way in and one way out.
Mm-hmm.
So that you once you get there, you're trapped. You know, then that also adds to the creepiness of the area, I suppose. And one thing about Egypt, there's a lot of family plot cemeteries there that people don't know about.
Oh yeah.
And I used to ride ATVs and things in there with my friends, and we came across several that are just unmarked. I'm sure they're not even, you know, in any historical sites to find, but they're just family cemeteries with...
Yeah, they didn't strip those out.
Right.
Anytime you see a tuft of trees on top of a hill, you're probably looking at a family cemetery.
Right.
And we actually, remember, Mike, about 3 years ago, we actually did go into somebody's cow field just because we wanted to get to this certain cemetery, and they're still there.
Yeah, they're still there. Actually,
they're totally forgotten, and, you know, totally, it's a mess, but they're still there.
We went to the one where they, where Johnny Fulkerson dug up that
mm-hmm.
casket for his daughter.
Yeah. You know, say that all one more time?
This was clear back in the 80s, wasn't it?
70s, uh-huh. Yeah, or late 70s, where a person lived down in the valley, right on the edge of Egypt. He actually killed his daughter in a hotel room. I mean, I'm not sure if I remember that or not.
It was a child custody issue, and he was a little unstable.
And he actually murdered his daughter and went and dug up a casket and put her in it.
Oh, so dug up a grave that was already there.
Yeah.
And
it was from an unmarked... I mean, if you didn't live there, you wouldn't even realize it's there. From the, you know, he lived down there his entire life.
Wow.
So, yeah.
And that's where they ended up finding him. Well, he actually turned himself in, finally.
Yeah.
But he hid down there for days. It's so easy to hide down there.
Oh, it's massive. It's massive.
Wow, that is an incredible story. Now,
yeah.
I know a lot of, one of the stories that I've heard of in this area is concerns two people that are buried in the same grave or the same cemetery. One of them murdered the other one. And if I remember correctly, I don't know if he was a lover of the girl.
Oh, yeah.
Or if he...
Are you talking about Louisa Fox?
That's the one, I think. Yes.
No, he's buried in St. Clairsville.
Okay.
They hung him at the courthouse, and he's buried during the parking lot unless they moved him.
Yeah.
She's buried down there. She's buried at Salem. And people go and leave her little gifts still, you know.
Okay.
Now, what is her story?
Oh, you want to tell it, Mike?
Well, yeah, the best I can remember is she was dating this Thomas Carr, and she broke it off with him, and she was walking.
And she was very young.
Very young, like 12, I think.
13, I think.
She was walking home from school, and he approached her, and, you know, she pretty much told him to get lost.
Now, how old is he?
He was 20.
He had been in the Civil War. He was a good bit older.
He was 20.
He had been a farmhand or something, and that's how he had come in contact with her. And they were... He was going to marry her, and her parents were like, no, you know.
And so she was walking home, and her brother was her older brother was in front of her. And they were
it was her younger brother.
Was her younger? You sure?
Yeah. He wasn't very old.
Okay. But he was in front of her, and Thomas Carr approached her, and she tried to get away from him, and he basically murdered her on the road to her home.
Oh, wow.
And... There's a marker down there.
There's a marker of her murder site because she was the first murder in Belmont County.
Yeah, she was the first murder, and
really?
He was the first murder.
You guys ought to come up and check this out.
Jordan, you're going to have to get over your
fear. No, see.
It's very historic.
Yeah.
That's like telling somebody who can't swim to jump in the ocean. See, I've been told, like, ever since... I've lived here for 8 years, and I've been told ever since I moved here, if you go there, you're going to die. They're going to kill you. So you're saying, sure, come on down.
That's
great. Let me show you something, some of these unmarked graves. And
I lived there and played there my entire life. We went fishing down there.
Still
during
do.
The weekends and overnight.
Pick raspberries. I mean,
yeah.
it's a beautiful, beautiful part of this
yeah.
state, really. It's beautiful down there.
I mean, you know, there are people that are kind of creepy that are down there, and there are things that happen down there, but...
There's creepy people everywhere.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
Now, we were talking earlier on a, what is the murder trial? I can't remember the boy's name. He killed his parents That in was it in the '80s, Biff? Do you remember
the Brooks? Was it the Brooks murder?
I remember.
He killed his parents, if I remember correctly. He killed his parents. He had beheaded them, from what I understand.
And it was
supposed to be, a satanic.
What?
This was in the 95 was when Steve mentioned. I cannot remember his name off the top of my head right now.
Do you hear about that, Mike? I don't know what they're referring to, do you?
No, in Egypt Valley, no.
Yeah, that happened in Egypt Valley. The host prior to this brought us in to talk about it because I guess he was one of the guys covering the press on that.
Hmm. I never, because there's very few families that live in Egypt Valley.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, there's. I don't know.
I didn't hear anything about that.
I don't either.
Honestly.
We'll find out something about it.
Nikki will figure it out. No worries.
Okay.
No. You guys. So. When you go in to do an investigation, what kind of stuff happens? Because, I mean, now is it mostly cemeteries that are there since all the houses have been stripped out?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So what kinds of stuff are you getting? Like you said, the orb, the rod, the glowing rod. What other kind of stuff are you guys getting?
Well, we get EVPs. We do take a lot of pictures. My sister-in-law, she takes thousands of pictures.
Yeah, she seriously does. She takes thousands. I'm not kidding you. It's unbelievable.
Thousands. And we do get some EVPs and, you know, just personal experiences, some weird feelings, lots of noises. Mostly, in Egypt Valley, it's you're out in the open, so you have to take it with a grain of salt that if you hear some leaves rattling, it's not necessarily going to be something paranormal. Mm-hmm. It could be an animal rippling around, but, I mean, there are definitely some things that happen down there you can't explain.
I know it's always hard to go into a wooded area and to do an investigation, just because it's hard to control your environment to some degree. What kind of methods do you guys use when you go in to investigate different places?
Well, in that kind of environment, about all you can do is try to watch your noise levels and be alert more than anything else for cars, because you can hear cars on the gravel roads. You can hear, because of the way the land is laid out, you know, valleys and hills and such, you can hear noise from, you know, far away if people are fishing or hunting or whatever they're doing or whatever. You can hear voices. So you got to try to distinguish if what you're hearing is actual, you know, at that time occurring. And, of course, you know, you don't go when it's raining and you don't go when it's foggy and, you know, so forth and so on. And you watch your light meters and stuff like that. And you really, pretty much any investigation, they're all about the same, really. This would be the difference of the animals or whatever in the woods around you would be your biggest.
Yeah, investigations outside are difficult. I mean, we've had a few of those, and there's so many factors that, you know, play into it that are beyond what you can actually control that you could inside of a house.
Mm-hmm.
Like, are there?
Well, it's two different sets of variables.
Yeah.
You know, in a house, your biggest problem is going to be electricity and lint.
Yeah.
And dust. That's going to be your biggest problems.
Now, how long have you guys been a group?
A group? It's been 7 years as
really?
A group.
7 years.
Now, did you guys, are you two like the founding members? Did you start
no,
this?
No, I have a friend and my sister-in-law both. My friend, actually, we've been friends forever. We were both nurses, for one thing, and we saw a lot of things as nurses, and she's a bit sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
And it just kind of took off from there. I have always just read since I was a teenager. I had an experience when I was 18. And that set me on the course of just starting to learn everything and trying to read. Because I'm older, and back then all you had was books. You didn't have the internet. You didn't have TV shows. You didn't have this kind of thing. You didn't have cable, for God's sakes.
No.
But, you know, reading. Read Edgar Cayce. Read Hans Holzer. You know, read these people and these basic books and get a background in what you're going for. And I read even into astrology and, you know, tarot and anything, because as much information as you have to start with. And then the investigations, I think how we started that, I was reading, Shadowlands. You familiar with Shadowlands?
I've heard of it, but I'm not
Okay, it's been around for a good while, and Obi-Wan, too, by the way. And they had this. They had on there how they were doing these investigations, how they were noticing these EMF fluctuations, and, you know, how they were starting to pick up these voices on these digital-type instruments. And that then, I think it was 2002 or 2003, we actually had our first investigation as a group, of which we had a laser thermometer, a cassette tape player, camera, and we couldn't afford a EMF meter at that time, so we had a magnet, which, by the way, it works. They
really?
Work. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, and then we just went from there, and we thought, well, and the more we did it back then, it was like, wow, this is fun, and we're going to find. It just kept going from there, really.
Now, I've noticed that I'm looking at different places you've investigated. One that I've heard mentioned is Prospect Place. Now, what exactly, can you tell us kind of a background on Prospect Place, or take a break real quick? And
it's up to you guys, whatever you want to do.
You want to take a break first, Nick?
Let's take a break. I want to also get some of your EVPs up, if that's okay with you guys.
Absolutely.
We'll talk
about
those.
Yeah, if you can get them off there, that'd be fine.
Right, okay, we'll go ahead and take a break and get that set up, and that way we can come right back to it. Is that cool, Biff?
All right, that's fine.
We'll be right back on AM 1600, WKKX, the Valley's Watchdog, and UPRN, the UFO Paranormal Radio. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Whispers Radio on AM 1600, WKKX, the Valley's Watchdog, and UPRN, the UFO Paranormal Radio Network. I'm Jordan Klein, he's Nick Queen, and the other he, sitting in for the lovely Lola Miller's brother Biff. Thank you, sir, for being with us tonight.
Oh, not a problem, guys. I enjoyed.
We always love having you. Our guests tonight, Egypt Valley Paranormal members Joni and Mike. They're getting ready to talk to us about Prospect Place. That's not in Egypt Valley, is it, Nick?
That I'm not sure about. Is it in Egypt Valley, guys?
No.
Prospect
not.
Place
no.
is right next to McDonald's, right? The Shriner?
No.
Is that it?
No, it's in Trenway, Ohio. It's up by.
Yeah,
what's that one called?
That's the Shriners?
Yeah, I thought that was called Prospect Place or something
no.
like that.
No. I don't All right, so tell us about what Prospect Place is.
Oh, Lord. Prospect Place is a mansion built in 1820s, was it, Mike?
Yes, 1824.
It's a long story. It's a really, really long. Some of it's on our internet site. www.gwacenter.org will tell you all about it. It's kind of been taken over by the government because it's being restored, and the great-great-grandson lives there and has been trying to do it himself, and it's just impossible. So it's kind of went under government control there for a while.
Mm-hmm.
But it was known, the guy was an abolitionist. He moved up here from Virginia, the guy that built it, and it turned out being a safe place, a safe house on the Underground Railroad. So it has all that history. It was pretty much a mess by the 1980s because most of the family died off and then you couldn't afford it, you know, and da-da-da-da-da. And Longaberger Basket stepped in, Dave Longaberger, and I'm sure you heard of Longaberger Baskets.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They're next door in Dresden. That's
My
where,
wife
that's
has
where,
one.
That's where
so.
Twinway is. Well, yeah, a lot of people do.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Nick's a collector.
Yeah. He stepped in and took over with some of the renovations, and he passed away, and then it's been... There was a doctor from Philadelphia that came down and lived there until he died, Felix Spector. Everybody's tried so hard to keep this place going and getting it renovated, and they've done a beautiful job so far. I'm just so happy with what they've done, but it still needs a lot more work. And they have, and George, the great-great-grandson of the loser now, he has opened it up for ghost hunts and or just historical tours, or, you know, just if you want to go out and stay the night and enjoy it, because what they have done is beautiful. And that's what Prospect Place is.
And what kind of things have you found there?
We have found, actually, the last couple times we've went, it's been rather quiet. Now, I don't know if that's because they have opened it up so much. Because I wonder sometimes if spirits don't get tired of people coming to their house all the time. Like, you know, will you people leave us alone, you know. But we have gotten EVPs. We've gotten pictures, of course, and video. The basement is a very unnerving place. The basement, they had a little girl fall off the balcony. Okay, she was, I think, anywhere from 12, 10 to 12, that area, in the middle 1800s. And she fell off a portico and fell onto, like, a granite porch underneath. Of course, it killed her in the winter. And they took her body because they couldn't dig, mm-hmm. and put her. They have one of the first ever. It's a refrigeration unit in the basement in one of the rooms, and what it is, it looks like a dry well. It's about what, Mike, 4 foot deep?
Yeah, well, about 3 foot deep and about 12 foot long.
Yeah, it goes clear back under the floor, and they have an air system set up where cool air would come in and refrigerate. That's where they put like their eggs and their milk and stuff like that, and they put her in that refrigeration place for till spring. And that is one of the hauntings, and we have never got a photo, but there have been a couple other groups in there that have got some pretty convincing photos of probably her. The ballroom, there's stuff throughout the place, but the ballroom seems to have a lot of activity, and the story there is there was some type of, it wasn't, the way I get it, it was people that went in after the place was deserted and was just sitting there. Because you know how people are. And there were some kind of rituals that went on up there, because there's still, like, stuff on the wall that they haven't covered up yet. And they said even animal sacrifices and that type of thing.
Wow.
That's upstairs in the ballroom in one corner. The others are said to be children and their nanny, because back then when you had a ballroom, that was also your playroom. And we have seen activity that's more childlike.
What would be activity that's more childlike?
We take a ball and uh-huh. we sit it there, and you know, we've checked the floor. It's level. There's the windows are covered. There's no wind up there at all because they have plastic over them. In fact, it's pretty hot up there. And that ball will move.
Yeah.
If you sit there and watch long enough, that ball will move.
It actually.
So that type of thing. And of course, EVPs. I think we got an EVP. Might have got a child EVP the last. We were there last month, I believe.
Wow.
The ball right for Halloween.
No, we had a guest on not too long ago. They brought like a big one of those big like kickball balls to an investigation they had, and they had the ball rolling around during an investigation. Something like you know you would think to take like a bouncy ball or something like that. They brought a big ball and it, like the kid was playing with it.
That's about that size.
Oh, so that's what you brought too?
Yeah.
See, when I think bring a ball, like I'm thinking like a baseball or, you know, like a little red ball you can hit with a bat, you know, something like that. You know, I wouldn't think to bring like a big like kickball, bouncy ball type of thing.
Well, it has to be something fairly light.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they have to use a lot of energy, exert a lot of energy even to make it wiggle. Last time we were there.
Yeah, we're not talking about it getting kicked clear over the, you know. We're talking about these minute, like Mike said, even little wiggles, and then it'll move for maybe an inch.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like they're playing kickball. It's not, you know. It's
oh,
not
yeah.
Well, actually, last time we were there, we were just getting ready to leave, and we were doing the dowsing rods. My son was dowsing, and they were getting kind of irritated with us, you could say. Like, they were getting tired, and basically wanted us to leave the room, and I was walking. You have the ballroom's in like a U shape, and we were on one corner to get to the door. You have to walk around the corner and around the corner and then out the door. Well, the ball was sitting on the floor, and I just said out loud, "We'll leave if you can just move the ball one more time." And as soon as I said that, the ball went clear across the room.
Wow.
And my son was like, "Why'd you kick the ball?" And I was like, "I didn't kick the ball." So yeah, that was probably the wildest thing that ever happened to me there.
Wow.
Was watching that. It was pretty extraordinary, actually.
Now, were you able to get that on video or anything?
We have a few pictures. I don't know if I haven't actually reviewed a whole lot of it yet, but I don't know if we have the actual movement of the ball. I know there were three of us up there, and we all were just like looking at each other for a second.
See, that's always it. When something really big and fun happens, you know, the camera's always pointed in the wrong direction.
Excellent. Yeah, exactly.
Well, you know, that's what makes me sane, because they do it on purpose sometimes.
Oh, yeah. They know what's going on.
You know, I just, like, they're like, go, okay, we're done. See you next time, you know. But we had a lot of activity this time, though. It seemed to be centered around the barn.
Yeah.
And in fact, I think we were all, the whole group of us, there was, how many went for us, Mike, five or six? Then I had my co-host on Midwest Paranormal, Paratalk Radio, came out from Indiana with a couple of his people, and we all eventually ended up together in that bottom of the barn because everybody was just like, so, there was so much to take in and so much to do. Everybody worked together so well, I was really happy with that. But the story of the barn is a story of a bounty hunter that had come to Mr. Adams back when it was on the Underground Railroad looking for slaves, you know, because he came to the house.
Well, hey, Jerry, I want to interrupt you real quick. We got a caller.
Okay.
Mike on four.
Yep.
Yeah, I want to interrupt you real quick. We're going to call her.
Mike, turn your radio down.
Mike on four.
Hi.
I feel like I'm in a vortex. How you doing, Mike?
Good. I'm doing good. I believe in a lot of stuff they're saying, but I mean, they, if you watch something long enough, don't you think you're going to see it move eventually?
Yeah, I can see where you'd say that, but you just got to see it. I can't tell you what it looked like. Your eyes will play tricks on you, but we take like tape, white masking tape. And we put the tape around the ball where it is originally, and then you got a pretty good idea which way it moved, how far it moved, and that type of thing. You just don't sit there and watch the ball.
Yeah, that sounds good. Because, you know, when I work in a coal mine, I'll turn my light off once in a while. It's dark.
Yeah.
I start seeing lights. You know what I mean? And it's pitch black. And there's no light, and I'll see a light. And I'm thinking, well, is it just me, or... So, I mean, I don't know. I mean,
there's some spirits under there with you, Mike.
Well, I'm sure there is. I've heard
My husband worked in a coal mine. He can tell you a couple coal mine stories.
Well, so. I mean, I know I've worked in the mine where guys have gotten killed. I've walked by this area shortly after, and I would see a light flash, and I would just stop and stand there, and I'd shine my light and shine it back and forth, and I'd try to make a slight move again. I thought it was a reflection, and I could not make that same reflection. So, I mean, you know.
Mine is total darkness.
Right.
The only thing you have to see where you're going is your headlamp.
It's my headlight. And I would flash that light back and forth, and there were some times where I couldn't, it wasn't reflecting off of something, and I'm thinking, so why was that light coming back?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I mean, but yeah, I mean, there has been. I mean, there's been, I forget the name of it, something about Valentine's Day, but yeah, I mean, there are a lot of things like that, and I'm sure there's a lot of people still underground, you know, well, we know there are.
Yeah, you never know the history of the earth, you know. You never know what went on before that's causing what's going on. I mean, there's just, the world's too big to know every inch of what's going on, and spirits are.
I'm going to lose you here very shortly.
All right, well, thank you for your call, Mike.
Okay, thanks. Bye.
So, I mean, it's good that you're testing stuff with tape. Have you tried, like, baby powder or anything like that? Wouldn't that work, too? Because you can see, like, the roll pattern.
We've used that for like footsteps. We never got anything with it.
No.
The baby powder, no, it doesn't seem to. I've never seen anything with baby powder. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, because when you tape it off, you measure it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You write on the tape the measurements, so you can, and then you go from there. And like I say, this can be an hour. Because they just don't do it because you want them to.
Oh, yeah, we definitely know that.
Yeah, I know you guys do. But for other people, yeah, they're not like circus animals. They don't say, yeah, we'll do that for you.
It's like move the ball. They're like, screw you, buddy.
Yeah, exactly. Go home, leave us alone. The bounty hunter was hung. After he got in with Mr. Adams, it got kind of violent. Mr. Adams went and got his Navy revolver, and the guy left and back to the woods to camp. Well, Mr. Adams was such a wonderful employer that his field helpers, and they all saw what happened. They went and got this guy that night, and he didn't know anything about it, and they brought him back to the barn and hung him out the haymow. Mm-hmm. And they'll even tell you out there, the people that have, like George and Randy, who's been a guide out there forever, and he was even there when it was deserted. He knows all about the place, and he says that be careful when you go in there. They've never had anybody actually hurt, but he does get cranky.
Very cranky.
Now we do have some EVPs. You know, we'd like to go. You know, share with the listeners. Let me see here. I'm looking at the different ones. Let's go ahead and Biff the second one on there. It says this is an EVP called an investigation. We asked anyone present if they wanted to speak. We think one of the words is home, but we aren't sure. Can you kind of tell us a little bit of a background on that before we play it?
We were in a cemetery. Well, I wasn't. This is my sister-in-law and a couple of the other members. I didn't go on that one. It's a cemetery close to here. they were actually practicing more than anything else, okay? Because when we get new equipment, we go out and use it before we ever try to investigate with it. So this was a practice run, and they were in one of the newer cemeteries over here in Bethesda, actually, not even in Egypt Valley. And they were out testing this equipment, and they were just asking questions, and they got that. Now, when they played that back, and then they went back to check where it came from, this is upsetting. There was a 17-year-old from here in town that had a terrible accident about 3 years ago, and he died.
Wow.
On the interstate, and that's where the vicinity of where this was picked up.
Okay, well, let's go ahead and take a listen to it, and then... Is there any way we can turn it up on the, there?
Okay. Yeah, he said it's up. Can we play it one more time, Biff? Or is it still going? Okay. Okay, so what are we, what part is it the...
Towards the end, yeah, I know it's real hard to hear, it's, I don't know that we could hear it on the recorder, but it's hard to hear on the website.
Yeah, it's hard to hear on here.
It's just like a, like that.
Oh, wow.
Okay, well, let's try another one of these then. Which one would you suggest? I see there's a couple of them here. There's
yeah,
one
either one
on
of those would be fine. Okay. One of them's a conversation, the other one's... Well, whichever one you want to play. Then I'll
Let's do the conversation. This is the 8mm camera. Can you give us a background on that one?
We got a call. It's been about 4 or 5 years ago, and I'd have to go back to look, but from a person that was having just strange things in her house, just noises, and they centered around this one room. So she was going out. In fact, they went out of town that night. She came and gave me the key. And I went over and I let in Marcia and Brenda, who are my co-founders. They were setting up, actually. We weren't even investigating it. This was like 6:30 in the evening. They were over there setting up this high eight in this specific room, but Brenda was putting it so it looked out into the hallway. So, as you can tell, she's just setting up her camera, getting ready, and she turned it back off. And as you hear her doing that, you'll hear Marcia come down the hall and start talking about smelling a flower or perfume or something. And in the background, there is a voice. There's a woman speaking, and you can hear her quite clearly.
Okay, so after she mentions the smell, there's a voice that's...
This is going on the whole time. Her and Brenda are talking about this perfume.
Oh, okay.
They didn't even hear this. We didn't hear it till we ran the tape the next day looking for evidence, and this is what we got on audio.
Now, it says here that there was nobody in the house, no TV, no radios on.
Nothing.
So this is completely silence. No one's there.
Nothing.
So let's go ahead and play it.
Yeah, let's hear that.
I don't know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, wow.
Okay, now, we ruled out everything we could. So I have a friend out in Indiana, and I have one in Massachusetts. And they're really good with EVPs, and they have all the high-tech, you know, megahertz. I'm not real techie.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I sent them copies of this video. And they cannot find that within the human range. They don't know what it is. But they even ruled out like walkie-talkies or even like those things on cars, you know, like when you OnStar.
Yeah.
They ruled that out even. They ruled
now,
out.
Could you make out what it was saying?
It sounded to us like it's saying it's welcoming somebody and giving them instructions.
Uh-huh.
I can't remember the exact words. They're on
the
website.
I've got the words here. Let me go ahead and read them. Then we'll listen to it one more time.
And there's a male voice in there, too, a low male voice, but it's not coming up on the website.
So it says, female, what's your name? Richard, have you had a rough detour? Male, low chuckle. Then let me know if you see anything. And the female, don't get lost on the other side. Be careful. You want to play it one more time? Do you think we got time?
Yeah, we got a couple minutes.
Yeah, let's go ahead and listen to it one more time after that.
There's definitely some voices.
It's pretty clear, too.
Mm-hmm. Can totally not explain them, and like I said, we've even had outside people trying to explain them. Nobody can explain them.
Wow. Now, somebody in... how far do you go on your investigations? Like, how far will you travel?
How we travel? For private investigations, we've never... Nobody's asked, so... generally around within a 20-mile radius for privates.
Mm-hmm.
If there's something... farther than that, because our problem is people work schedules,
yeah,
children, and that we will, if it's somewhere we can't get right away, that they, if they really need help, we will pass it on to one of our other groups.
Okay, like that, some friends that you know.
Huh?
Friends that you know that are in the area?
Yeah, other groups that we know are good. Like, say, if you're in Gulf Kick at a Dayton, I will call up Steve and say, Steve, here's the case.
Yeah.
It's like a little bit of a... networking.
Oh yeah.
But it's only people that we know are going to do what they're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
So
now, if anybody wants to get a hold of it, because we only have a couple minutes left, they can go to your website. I'm guessing. Can you get that address again?
It's www.egyptvalleyparanormalinvestigations.com, and also we have a MySpace, which is MySpace/astralcritters. ASTRALCRITTERS. Is our MySpace page.
And also your radio show.
Oh, the radio show.
Yeah, I want to make sure we get to that. So.
Yeah, we got like a minute, so...
Okay.
Midwest
Paratalk Radio. It's on the ASPRN network, ASPRN.com. It's every Thursday evening at 10 o'clock. Thursday night is a good night to go in. We have a lot of... We start at 8 o'clock and have three very good shows in a row. But there are shows on there about every evening.
What time is your show again?
Our show is starts at 10 o'clock on Thursday evening.
There we go. And
with Greg Cable from Indiana.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. We'll be listening to that. Our listeners out there, why not listen to them? Fun times for everybody to be had. EgyptValleyParanormalInvestigations.com. If you're in the area looking for some help, got some questions, get to them. I want to thank you very much for your time today. We are out of time, and we got to cut to the news. So, Joni, Mike, I want to thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you
for
being our guys.
It was great.
Yeah, we really appreciate the stories, and we'll be talking to you again.
Anytime.
All right, okay. See you guys.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, how much more time we got till we got to cut right now?
We got about a minute, guys.
Okay.
I did know you wanted to say something about the water found on the moon.
Yeah, did you hear about this, Biff?
They found water on the moon.
They said it wasn't just because they knew they had a little bit of water. They found a lot of bit of water. You know, there was like
a bit of water.
Shut up, Nick. I guess on like to where the poles were, they found like really, really, really deep craters.
It was from that. If you remember a while back, they were going to bomb the moon. You had people, you know, talking about NASA's bombing the moon, which was, you know, they shot a probe into the moon.
What they wanted to do
is get this probe to, you know, throw out this plume of liquid or you know, water, and they did, and they found water. So
that's awesome.
It's awesome.
Next step, admitting there's life. Come on, Obama. What's your problem? We'll be right back with Brook County Paranormal talking about the bones that they found. You're listening to Whispers Radio on AM 1600 WKKX, the Valley's Watchdog. Hello, everybody, and welcome to hour number two of Whispers Radio. It is 7:09 p.m., 58 degrees here in downtown Wheeling. Numbers are 304-214-1600. If you're out of the area, 1-866-514-1600. I'm Jordan Klein here with Nick Queen and the lovely Biff Leonard.
Thank you.
How does that? See, Lola blushes every time the announcer says her name. Like, did you blush at all when I said the lovely Biff Leonard?
I don't know. I couldn't tell.
I mean, teary-eyed at all? Did I get
gets
nothing?
A little smiley. Oh. Like, oh, boy.
You know, it happens. With us in the studio today, Brook County Paranormal. You've heard maybe them in the news from the news media about a certain investigation they were on where they found certain things in a wall. Members with us today are Kathy. Kathy, you want to say hi?
Hello.
Rick.
Hello.
Rodney.
Hello.
And Cody. All right, how you guys doing? Everybody doing good?
Yeah, we're doing good.
All right, don't be nervous. I don't bite. Nick, however, you're sitting at the table with Nick.
I'll restrain myself.
He's holding back. That's what kind of fella he's on. He is. We got a call?
We've got Len.
Hey, Len.
Hey, good evening, you guys.
Good evening.
Could I tell a really quick Egypt Valley story?
Oh, well, sure.
I have a cabin that sits on about 6 acres out there. Are you there?
Yep.
And a friend of mine wanted to write a story about the car being hanged, Thomas Carr, who murdered the girl. So I took her to the cemetery where the girl was buried, and we had the camcorder running, and she was telling the story as I was camcording her, and she went over and she said, "I'm going to lay down on her grave." And so when she laid down on her grave, the camcorder shut off.
Ooh.
And we just kind of got this cold feeling run through us, and I said, "Come on, let's go get in the car and get out of here." And she was kind of freaked, too. So we got up, got the car, it came back on. But when we rewound it and played it, it was like above her was like a shadow figure.
Really?
And, yes. She hasn't got the book quite finished yet, but it was and it's weird things always happen out there where that girl's buried in that cemetery.
Well, that was weird, too.
I thought if you guys would ever want to go out there, I'd be happy to take you out sometime.
No, see, this is what's scary. Like, still, I'm not convinced that everybody who's inviting me to go out there is not going to kill me once I get there.
Well, I have a cabinet. I'm out there all the time by myself. And, you know, I'm not afraid.
Again.
But anyway, I just wanted to get that quick story in there.
Well, that's awesome. Thank you very much, Len. Have a good night.
You too.
I want to book a psychiatrist for you one day.
I don't know, somebody who's going to go out to Egypt Valley knowing that they could die and then go lay on a grave and want to go back.
That's just crazy.
And I live by myself. Come on out.
All right, let's go back to Brook County then.
All right, you guys, Aspen Manor, tell us how this happened, Kathy. Get right up in the microphone for me.
Me and my husband was actually sitting at the local Dairy Queen. He had, for some reason, just said, "We have to go to Aspen Manor." And I'm like, "What for?" And he said, "We just need to go." So we went up and did a day tour of the place. We were walking through the basement area, and I had said, "I feel like someone's buried here." Well, never thinking anything, just went on with the day tour. We planned on going back up. We scheduled Friday night to do the investigation. Friday night, everybody got together. We went up there. Started doing an investigation, did some EVPs, some taping and some videos. My group that was with me went to the basement, took some photos, that sort of thing, and we ended up in that room where I had mentioned that someone had died and or were buried. And we were looking around and stumbled upon a bone on the floor. Kind of examined it, thinking, "Oh, maybe it's just an animal."
Now, how big was the bone?
The first one we found was really small, maybe 2 inches, very first one.
Now, is this, here's my question here. Is this a place that hasn't been investigated before? Like, are you guys like the...
We're the very first
first people in there?
Yes, he's had mediums in there before, but no paranormal investigators.
Okay.
So we ended up just looking around and stuff like that, and I seen a few more bones, picked them up, kind of looked at them, and we were wandering around a little more, course, it's pitch dark, and we got a flashlight. We saw a hole in the wall, so we decided to go over and just check it out. So we put the flashlights in there and noticed the wall was full of these bones. We went, started digging them. We started digging the bones out.
Now, did the wall already have a hole in it?
Yeah, the wall actually
did. So you
didn't
beat a hole into the wall, you know, take a crowbar and be like, I'm doing this for justice. And
no, actually, they said the wall was like, the house was built actually in 1901, from what I've been told.
Uh-huh.
And the wall just was, I guess, deteriorating over time. Where the mortar had come loose is where the hole was. That's where we actually located them at.
Now, before you said that you went on the day tour and you had this kind of this feeling. Now, are you psychic? Do you think you're psychic? Or
no, I don't claim to be psychic. I think everybody is born with some kind of psychic ability, and things sometimes just happen or come to people for a reason. And I mean, we kind of feel that there was a reason why we were led up there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, if you don't, I'm sorry. If you don't mind, try to get a little closer. That way, it'll pick up better. That's all. I was looking just a little low. So, but now, I had a question and I lost it.
Nick's a stickler for that podcast. I'll tell you what.
Well, you know, I want to be able to hear. You know, it'd be bad if it's just me asking a question and then me. It's like, oh, really? You know, there's nothing between.
Everybody here was at the mansion.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Cody, lead up to the mic for me, or pull that over to you. All right, how old are you, Cody?
I'm 16.
16. You know, you're going into this place. How long have you been doing investigations?
About a year.
About a year. What were you thinking during all this?
Well, we got some pretty crazy feelings in there. Me and my dad got chased out from downstairs and felt like something was above us, you know.
Now, when you say chased out, I have to ask.
Now, is Kathy saying, get out of here?
No, she was in the other part of the house at the time, because it's a really big house, and we had to split up into groups. But it's just, you know, you get feelings like there's something there. And I just guess you get feelings.
What kind of feeling do you need that...
Like a pit in your stomach, kind of, I got to get out of here type of thing?
Like a being watched feeling.
Okay.
And we were actually up by the nun's quarters, and my dad got pushed down some steps and cut his wrist open.
Now, and this is you, Rick? Lean into the mic, too.
Yeah,
you got.
Yeah, that was me.
So you were pushed. You guys are both downstairs, and then you get pushed.
Yes. We were up in the nuns' quarters and everything, and I was trying to do some EVPs, and the next thing I know, something had shoved me from behind, and I had went down some steps, and then I got slammed into a wall, and my wrist was cut open, and it was bleeding pretty bad.
Wow.
Now, what kind of questions were you asking? I have to ask.
Well, some of the stories that I heard involved nuns performing abortions. Like I said, those are just stories. They're hearsay. And I was just asking out of curiosity if that had actually happened or not. And the next thing I know, I was getting shoved. And, I mean, I'm a big guy, and yeah, it had to be something big to move me.
Now, did you feel anything? Was there any, like, other than getting cut, and I'm thinking that's from falling, is there any, did you check for any marks or anything of where you were?
No, I was shoved from behind, and my wrist was bleeding pretty bad, so I immediately
went. Were
you
thinking about that? Yeah.
No, my one investigator, Michaela Sims, she was with me, and she had went back downstairs with me to help me get cleaned up and everything.
Now, who else was in the room with you when that happened, when you were shoved?
My son, Cody.
Now, did you notice anything when he was shoved, or were you shoved also? Or
no, I was the only person behind him, and I mean, I definitely can't push him.
Did you shove him?
Now, we're here. We won't let him hurt you. Now, Roddy, make sure everybody gets some mic time. Where were you at during all this?
I was sitting in the nun's quarter.
You were in the nun's quarters?
Yeah.
Now, did anything happen to you? Did you feel anything? Were you getting any feelings, impressions?
Not when I was up there.
Okay. So, all this is going on, and we find bones, okay? What was the first thought to your head? Like, okay, we found bones. Because I know if I see bones, I'm like, I've been up to places and found like a dead deer on the ground. I'm like, oh my God, why is there a dead deer here? Oh my God, you know, just because. That's just how I am.
The initial bone that was found on the floor, actually, that's what I said. Well, that's just kind of strange. Maybe something drug something in.
Mm-hmm.
But when we actually found the bones that were in the wall, the wall was full of them. I was like, wow. I mean, I didn't really even know what to think. It was just kind of strange. And like I said, we actually pulled all that we could get out of them onto this third area on the floor. And we were all talking about them. We actually had a dentist from Pittsburgh with us, which was spending the night up there.
Mm-hmm.
His wife had took him for his birthday. And he actually went with us, and he was actually down there when we located the bones.
Wow.
So he actually had said, well, you find a jawbone, I should be able to identify that. So we actually did actually locate a jawbone, and he said it did, from what he said, it did look human, but he couldn't guarantee it because they were so cut. They were actually precisionally cut with some kind of saw of some sort or knife.
Wow. All right, we got a call on 5.
We've got Charlie.
Charlie.
Yeah, how you doing? I've got a question for Rick.
You want to put the headphones on, Rick? Hold on just a second. We
shoestring budget here.
All right.
Hey. I was wondering, are you sure it wasn't Kathy or Cody that pushed you down them steps?
I don't know. At times, the way Kathy likes to argue with me, I have my doubts that it may have been her.
The whole nature of the show is about the change.
Well, I had to call in because that's my brother on there.
Oh, okay.
Hey, Charlie.
Hi, Charlie.
I'm sitting on your guys' website right now.
Oh, great.
We'll get off here and let you guys talk.
Thank you, Charlie.
All right.
So now, does Kathy beat you a lot?
Yes, she does. Very much.
My wife, she beats me in front of my friends.
Yes, she does.
Now, Kathy, you were saying that the bones looked like they had been precisionally sawed. Okay? Is this like something was chewing at them, like rat teeth sawed, or like... I just murdered my buddy, and I'm going to hack him up and throw him in the wall.
That's exactly what it
Make sure you're getting
like.
A little close. Sorry.
They were actually, like, where they were cut was even. You know, the marks were pretty even. They weren't tore up like it would be if something was chewing on them. It was like a flat cut, like I said, would be done by some kind of sharp instrument. And the largest one that I had found was probably about 3.5-4 inches long. But it was, of course, cut, so before it had been a lot larger.
So none of the bones were big because everything was cut up so small.
Yeah, everything was cut really small. Like I said, the biggest one was probably 4.5 inches, probably at the most.
Wow. Now, how big around? Like, are we talking like a femur bone or?
Yes, there was actually a femur bone that was found. It wasn't a real large bone, but it was a femur, probably the size of maybe an orange, like a small orange, the top part of it. But like I said, they weren't real big because they were all cut, you know, so they were cut up pretty small.
Yeah.
Now, were any of these, did you find anything that was identifying, like a skull or anything that would look distinctly human?
Like you look at it and say,
that has to be human.
That's the guy that's who I'm here for.
No, actually, like I said, there was a lot of small pieces that could have been a skull that was crushed to fit into the wall because the area where they were at wasn't a large area. I think that's why they were cut to be put in there. The area, like, was really, really small. Like, we could put our arms in there, and that's about it.
So you were just, like, reaching in and digging around?
Yeah.
You were tampering with the crime scene?
Yeah, I know. After everything was said, yeah, we kind of, like, oh, my fingerprints is all over this. I hope it's not a new crime.
I killed somebody 100-some years ago.
Yeah, and came back.
Put them in a wall.
We've actually had people... say that.
Now, if you did that, we would love to speak to you about that as well.
Yeah, we have a time
while
capsule.
The trial's going on. Well, yeah.
Now, you know, when I think of something, you know, something like this, there's always, you know, especially if this bone, you'll see like clothes laying over there or something else. Is there anything else that was in the wall other than the bones?
When we found them, no. But actually, the police department, when they were called in, the sheriff's department came up, and they actually broke another block underneath that one.
Uh-huh.
And they actually found a pair of old wireframe glasses, which probably they saying dated back probably to that era when the house was built, which was in like the early 1900s.
Wow.
They found hair, actually hair there. Some comic book things and some kind of like wire type thing. They're not sure what it was. Little pieces, round pieces of some type of jewelry or where they're not positive what actually.
So maybe
it was.
Like a bracelet or
maybe.
Wow.
So, but I think they said something about some comic book type paper in there too.
So I mean really when you're thinking of it was just like an impression that you got that you just had to hey, I have to go here.
Yeah, it's just kind of a feeling. I mean, I don't know what. Like I said, I kind of blew it off after I had said it because I never even thought twice about even going back down in there and locating these bones.
Oh, wow. We got Bill on, too?
Yes, we do.
Bill, how we doing?
Okay. Now that you know what the bones are, what do you think about it?
Well, we're not positive if they haven't come back yet, if they're human or if they're animal.
They said they were chicken and horse and possible cow.
Yeah, we haven't actually heard that yet. Our sheriff's department actually, they went from our sheriff's department to, I think, Charleston, and from there they went to the Smithsonian to do more research because they did say they found human DNA.
Oh, is that right? Yeah, there probably is something in there. You know?
So they're only they've only released so far. Where'd you see this on? Broadcast earlier.
Yeah, a couple hours ago, they said they found some chicken bones and some maybe horse and cow bones from some sort of slaughter outfit going on or something. But I wouldn't be surprised if there's human bones in there.
Yeah, if they're saying they found some human DNA, maybe they're just not releasing it all yet.
Exactly. Yeah.
Oh wow.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Hey, thanks, Bill. Okay, so if they're hiding some stuff. Well, first of all, okay, let's say it's all chicken bones and horse bones. Why are they in the wall?
That's what we can't figure out.
I mean, even if
insulation.
You have
insulation.
Cuz
back in the old days, we used to kill chickens and horses and just throw them in the wall.
That's when they made doing it with nuns, you know.
That's the big mystery. I mean, everybody has actually said, "Well, if there's nothing human there, why were they actually put in there?" I mean, what would be the purpose of actually putting them in there and sealing them into a wall?
Now, was this, I'm trying to remember exactly, because like I've never been there, so I'm not sure. Is this close to where maybe a kitchen was at some point? And maybe a lazy butcher just wanted to throw stuff in? I mean, my mind's going through different things. I'm sorry.
It's actually the main part of the the upper part would be the main part of the mansion.
Mm-hmm.
Where we actually found them is a dirt area, which wasn't used for anything. I mean, the floor is completely dirt. There's
or like a
path.
Storage, maybe.
No, there's not even anything.
Really?
There's anything's in there is like pipes. You can actually see some of the pipes from the house. But there's actually a dirt, the floor's dirt, and in the dirt, there's actually like a thing dug through, like someone was making some kind of passage way through there.
Wow.
I don't see how there would have been anything in there. I mean, the dirt is probably knee high, so that's all around you. I mean, you just have this little area that you actually can walk through.
Yeah?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Something in my throat. Now, what exactly happened? You find these. Who did you report it to at that point?
Did you call the police right away, or did you stay and play for a while?
Actually, they were doing the investigation, and Mr. Valentine, which owns the mansion, was actually out of town. He had just come in from Switzerland, and he was kind of jet lagged, I would say. He was really, really tired, and I introduced myself. It was the first time I had met him.
Mm-hmm.
He was a really nice gentleman. He had, you know, I had mentioned that he said, you know, if we find anything, I was telling him that we did find the bones in the wall. And I don't know if he kind of was tired and he just didn't hear me or what, but then the following day we went up there and I asked them if they had reported them. And they said they were afraid to report them because they weren't sure if they were animal or human. And I was like, well, you know, we need to report these just in case. So they actually did call the sheriff's department. Brook County Sheriff's Department came up and actually, like I said, they broke another part of the wall out, which is weird is they were old terracotta blocks. So the blocks, instead of having holes go up and down like our blocks do, they go straight across. So you could actually look through one block and see through the rest of them. There's a top and a bottom to these blocks, and the one that they broke out was the one below there, and there would have been no way for the bones to have fell down through to that block, so they actually had to have been put in each block.
Oh, wow. So they were purposely there.
Yeah, they actually, someone had to actually purposely put them there.
Why?
Yeah, that's what we're like, why?
Why?
Now, did you do any EVP in this area?
Yeah, they actually, one of the girls from the group did EVP there. As far as I know, they didn't get anything on the EVP there.
Okay, so, we got, you know, the impression, the presence that that the investigation has to be done. We find the bones that are, whatever they are, shouldn't be in a wall. We get somebody pushed into a wall, and two people, you know, pushed out of a room.
Yeah.
You know, and do we have anything on video?
Far as I know, no, I didn't see anything. I mean, we're going to review it again, because we review it several times. But,
yeah.
There is a lot of history to the house itself. Like I said, it was built back in the 1900s. The guy who owned it, he actually built it, was Mr. Vandegrift. He actually built it as like a Playboy place for him and his friends. There was actually a racetrack up there. They had illegal drinking. They had gambling, prostitution. Actually, some of the presidents, actually, from what I was told, actually went there. So they actually have a tunnel somewhere. We haven't located exactly where it's at yet, but there's actually a tunnel that's supposed to go from there down over the hill from the mansion. So when they got raided, they actually, these rich people could get out of there without getting caught.
Oh, really?
His wife, Mr. Vandegrift's wife, supposedly came up missing. Stories are that she actually was having an affair with a stable hand, and she came up missing.
And he was cut up and put into a wall?
Yeah. But,
or she was.
Oh, he actually died later in the year.
Stable
so
boy
actually,
with his horses.
Yeah,
there we go.
Yeah, he actually, I guess, he had a love for his horses and his gambling and everything, and he, I guess, didn't pay much attention to her from what I've been told, you know, from what I've did history. But she came up missing, and no one ever investigated that, because there was other people that knew, I guess, that she was having this affair, so they assumed that what he was saying was true, that she ran off the stable hand.
Wow.
Not very long after that, Mr. Vandegrift ended up leaving the mansion, left everything he owned there. All the old furniture and everything, the original furniture, everything was left there that he had owned. He didn't take anything with him. He ended up moving to New York. Later on, I guess, from what I read, he actually got remarried and had a couple other children. But, I mean, there's
now, what kind of position? What kind of condition is this place in right now?
Very beautiful. Like I said, very, very beautiful place. Lot of history, lot of antiques. The architecture is just beautiful.
Is it kept up? Is there like a company or somebody who lives there that keeps it up still, or is it?
Yeah, they actually have people that work there, and they actually have a lady who lives there and helps clean it. Mr. Valentine actually lives in the upstairs. When he's in town, he does do a lot of business out of town. There's a manager, Russell. He's up there. He actually takes care of the. It's actually a bed and breakfast now. You actually can go there and spend the night.
Really?
Yes.
I don't know if I'd want to stay a night in the place that there's people in the walls.
Jordan during
See,
this
I
show
like,
has become
I like to be
scaredy cat.
I like to be dangerous.
Yeah.
Kinda.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to take a break. You're listening to Whispers Radio on AM 1600, WKKX, the Valley's Watchdog, and UPRN, the UFO Paranormal Radio Network. We'll be right back. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Whispers on AM 1600 WKKX, the Valley's Watchdog in UPRN. I am enjoying being sick a little bit because my voice sounds deeper, and Nick says that I usually laugh like a little girl. And I know, like, the last guest we had, I was like, and he was like, wow, that sounded like a fake laugh. I was like, that's the best I got. Oh, anyway. I'm Jordan Klein. He's Nick Queen. He's Biff Leonard. And they are Brook County Paranormal. I actually just saw a picture of the bones they had on the computer. And they can say that they're chicken bones all they want. But it looks like it came from me. They're pretty big. Biff, would you agree?
Yeah, there's some big bones. You know, I got to see the picture as well, and they're big. Yeah. I mean, they certainly, you know, if you think of an animal, it looks like it will come from a big animal. Certainly not a chicken.
Yeah.
If any animal, it's a big animal.
Jordan and I both know chicken bones.
I'm no stranger to the chicken bone. There's a picture of a pelvis, right? There's like a pelvis bone, and it looks like a human pelvis, does it not, Biff?
Yeah, it certainly does. I mean, it's you got to see it to believe it.
We're working on. He's trying to connect to the wireless in here, which, let me tell you, my friend, when Nick's computer's up and running, there's no getting on the internet.
I steal everything.
He steals all the bandwidth available. But we will have those pictures up on whispersradio.com here in the next little bit. And you see for yourself. I mean, if you want to call it farm animal bones, I mean, I don't know.
Be our guest, for sure.
Good luck. I mean, I'd like to see the paperwork. I say they're trying to call it something to do their own investigation quietly.
Are you about to blame Obama for
Obama?
No. Okay, no. All right, let's get back to what happened at the... So, we got people being pushed around, bones found, mass hysteria. What else happened at the investigation? I mean, how long was the investigation?
We actually probably got there around 7 or so. We did about 7 hours of investigation of the place. Like I said, it's a very large place.
Okay, so, I mean, your whole time was spent doing stuff. I mean,
yeah, our group broke up into groups, smaller groups, and we actually, each person went somewhere else in the mansion. We had to spread out because the place is so big. Like, some of us went downstairs, some went upstairs. There's actually, like, 3 floors to the place. I don't even know how large the building itself is, but... Very, very big.
Now, when you guys do investigations, I know when Nick and I... Yeah, there we go. When our group was, you know, pretty active, one of the things that we did, we called it ghost watching. And we set up all of our devices and everywhere we thought we'd get the most activity, and we'd kind of sit for an hour. Let everything run, get like a baseline reading of what was going on. Do you guys do anything like that?
Actually, we go in and we, like I said, we usually just go in and do a pre-walkthrough during the day to see exactly how big the place is. And,
mm-hmm.
We would not have had even close to enough equipment to do the air, you know, because we weren't sure exactly where all the activity was in the place.
Yeah.
Like I said, we would have had to have probably every news channel around equipment to do the whole building. I mean, it's so massive.
How many rooms is in that place?
I don't exactly know. Like I said, I know it's 3 stories. It's actually, there's 2 sections. There's actually the main mansion, and then later on the years, they actually added on an assisted living home because it was actually an assisted living home.
Okay, so this isn't like a 4-bedroom house. This is...
Oh, no, there's probably... hundreds or more,
of rooms.
Yeah.
You split up and you go, and you guys didn't catch any EVP with all this?
Yes, Rodney, which is with us, he got a few EVPs.
All right, Rodney, what did you get?
I was in the chapel, and you'll hear like the old radiator heaters kick in.
Uh-huh.
Well, after it kicked in, you hear a little voice say, "What's that?"
Really?
That was in the chapel room when me and Cody was investigating.
Okay, so you guys were together in the chapel doing that. And is that the only EVP you got?
No, then I was sitting in the first floor by myself because I was doing an investigation by myself all night.
Uh-huh.
And within like 2 minutes of my recording, I had a woman's voice down the hallway, and I couldn't understand what she was saying to me. So there was a lot of activity.
Now, was that audibly, or was that just through the...
my recorder.
Just through your recorder, couldn't make out what she was saying?
No. Because the nuns up there, there was, I think, 6 nuns that stayed up there when it was Catholic nights, and one spoke German.
Oh, really?
So I don't know if that was her trying to speak her language or something. I don't
know. Now, did it sound like kind of Germanic?
I couldn't actually pick it out what she was trying to say.
Oh, really? Do you have these EVPs on your website?
Actually, I think they put one EVP up. My husband actually was there and up in the nuns' quarter and actually got what sounds like the old clickers that they actually, the nuns used to use to quiet down kids or quiet down people.
Uh-huh.
You can actually hear that, like what sounds like a clicker.
Really?
Yes.
Now, so, is that off of, if you go on the website, and maybe Biffy, if you don't mind pulling it up, brookcountyparanormal.com. If you click on the link at the top where it says Aspen Manor Investigation, is that where they're posted? Rick? All right, very good. And so maybe we can play one of those over the air. Okay, so I see here where it says the clicker, so that'll be it. So we'll try to get one of those play. Now, were you given full access to the place? Were there people staying there while you were there?
Anybody that was actually spending the night, like I said, there was a dentist out of Pittsburgh. He was there with his wife. She had brought him there for his birthday, and they were going to go to Cabela's the next day. He was with me and a couple other people when we actually did locate the skeletal remains. Besides that, that was the only people actually spending the night there. There was actually some of the employees were actually there. The manager Russell was there, and a couple other people who work there. Besides that, and then our group, we had full access to the building. The only room we couldn't actually go in was the room that they were spending, the dentist when his wife was spending the night, because she actually stayed in a room, because I think it kind of creeped her out a little
freaked
bit.
Freaked her out.
Yeah. She was a real nice lady, but it kind of creeped her.
How long have you guys been together as a group?
We've been together for 2 years.
For 2 years?
Yes.
What got you started?
My husband's actually from New Orleans, so that's the most haunted place there is, I think.
Yeah, we hear lots of stories about New Orleans.
So he actually is the one that kind of started everything. We just started, one day decided we're going to start, we're going to start a paranormal group. So we ended up starting a paranormal group, bought a few, few things equipment-wise, and we've just been building from there.
How many investigations have you done? How often are you doing investigations?
We try to do them as often as we can. We actually probably try to do at least 3 or 4 a month. Sometimes we don't get that many in.
Yeah.
Since this has all happened, we've had a lot of phone calls and a lot of emails wanting to do investigations.
Now, the most of what you're doing, did you start off just seeking out places, or did people just automatically start?
We actually started out doing some research online and some reading at the library and stuff of places and contacting them and asking, if we were able to come in and actually do an investigation. Then later on, we actually got our business cards and actually started getting the group together, and we actually started getting people calling us and contacting us to do house investigations.
Where exactly have you investigated in Brook County itself?
We've actually did Bethany College, Campbell Mansion,
really?
Campbell Cemetery. We have done the Wellsburg Glass Factory, Aspen Manor, of course. Did Brook County Cemetery before. That's about the only places I can think of. Can you think of any place else, Rodney or Rick, in Brook County? No.
No, we had a caller not too long ago. Man, it's going to kill me. What was that? It was like Skull Hollow, Skull Road, Skull...
It was something like Skull Hollow.
Skull Hollow is right off from Aspen Manor, actually. It's a road right beside Aspen Manor's road.
Okay, and I know he was asking, and I'm glad you guys are here because I remembered that. Is there anything that's gone on in that area?
I haven't actually heard of, I've heard stories people seeing stuff. Actually, there's supposed to be a cemetery up in that area that people claim they've seen, full body apparitions and stuff like that. Actually, it's on private property, so we actually haven't located exactly where it's at and who actually owns the property to get permission, because we like to get permission before we go on to any kind of, you know, cemetery or private property.
Yeah, and that's good. There's so many paranormal groups starting now that, you know, don't have that respect. You know, they'll just go anywhere and everywhere just because they think they can, because they have a camera, and don't respect the property, don't respect the land, don't respect the laws, and it gives a lot of us a bad name. So I applaud you for that very much. Sorry, I'm getting snotty.
Now, from talking to you on the phone, I know there's you went more outside of the area than you have in Brook County itself, correct?
Yeah.
Now, where else have you went outside of the area?
We actually have done Egypt Valley that they were talking about earlier. We've been there a couple of times. We've actually did Mary Stuckem Cemetery, which is over in Coshocton, Ohio. We've actually did an investigation down in Virginia, Kentucky. Several house investigations. We actually can't give the names of, you know, the people,
of course.
But, you know, we've traveled a little bit, like not real far. We've actually went down for fun and actually did the Mothman prophecies down there. But
see, I love it.
Yeah, we actually went down there one day. We went to do a house investigation downstate. So on our way back, we actually stopped off and, you know, did some stuff and some research on the Mothman.
Let me tell you what, that is the best little town you could ever go to. Everybody there is so friendly.
I thought they were kind of, not to be mean, but kind of strange.
Really?
No, yeah, they were
friendly. You can feel when you get out. I guess I'm a weird guy, so I fit in well. I don't know. But, I mean, you can feel when you get out of your car, there's, like, a feeling.
You know,
something happened there.
Yeah.
But, like, we went into, I went with my mom and my little brothers. We were just like, hey, let's take a road trip down. And went into, like, this little diner. All the people just sitting there working, just talking to everybody, you know. It's like being in an Andy Griffith show or whatever. And a little old lady comes up, and she's like, hey, there's a art opening. Come on, you can be my guest. And it's like VIP, special invitation only. And here we are, you know, going to, like, this town's big meeting. And we're like, hey, everybody, you know.
Yeah, people are really
nice.
Yeah, people are really friendly there. You just got that strange feeling when you, like you said, we got that strange feeling. We actually went out to the bunkers and actually waited, because they just had flooded the area there. So we actually waded up to our knees in water back into the bunker area.
Oh, that's kind of creepy.
Yeah, it was kind of crazy.
I don't know if I'd be that dedicated. I'd look at it through binoculars. I don't think I'd swim there.
It was kind of funny because the guy locally in town had told us that if you went so far back that you'd get shot at. Well, we were walking back through the bunkers.
Well, a lot of the bunkers, because that whole area, a lot of those bunkers are leased out to government still. And, like, there's supposed to be tunnel systems and everything all underneath Point Pleasant, because that was all, like, military holding and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I don't disagree with him there.
Yeah. We actually heard gunshots. It was kind of funny because it scared us. So we kind of were, like, trying to wade through the water really fast. But then after we left and we drove down the road a little ways, there was actually a place to shoot guns.
No.
So they were down there. A bunch of people were down there practicing, I guess, target shooting. So it's just kind of funny because it kind of startled us. We thought we were getting shot at.
Yeah, I'd have ran. I wouldn't have figured out that much. I'd have been out of there. Cody, I got a question for you, man. At 16 years old, what got you into all this?
Well, my mom and dad started the group, so I just started going with them. And
so have you always been into it? Have you always been? Because usually, and you know, we get guests on here that say, oh, you know, we wrote a book, you know, specifically for teenagers who are wanting to get into ghost hunting, you know, because they'll do whatever. And, you know, I remember when I was your age, I was, like, looking at Ouija boards and all kinds of weird crap. But, you know, you're already in the system, as in, you know, you're using equipment, you're using, you know, you're scientifically going about it instead of using, you know. Well, I don't want to go ahead and say you're not using Ouija boards. Are you using Ouija boards?
No, we don't use Ouija boards.
Okay, see, and most teenagers be like, that's the first thing we're going to buy, you know? So what's been your inspiration through this, man?
Well, at first, I really wasn't into going at all. I was kind of scared of it and everything. But, I mean, my dad asked me if I wanted to go on one, and I said, you know, I guess I'll try it out. And then, I mean, it just grew from there, and, you know, curiosity gets you.
Yeah. What's the craziest thing that's happened to you?
We were, probably when we were at Campbell's Mansion, we were down in the basement. It's the most active place in the mansion. And I was standing up in the middle of the room. And every time someone stands up in the middle of the room, we get really bad feelings, like something's wanting us to sit down. So I was standing there, and I actually, I couldn't see from my knees down. It was nothing but a black fog, and they said that my feet were, like, a foot off the ground.
Oh, wow. Wow. Now, how'd you deal with that, like, mentally?
It took a while to sink in, but once it hit me, you know, I was pretty freaked out about it.
Back for more, then?
We haven't been back yet. we probably will be, though.
There you go. Are you excited to go back and try that again, or?
I'm not sure if I'm going to stand in the middle of the room again, but I'll definitely go back.
Okay, now what? How do I want to say this? I don't know. I'll just forget that. Keep doing what you're doing, buddy.
Now, has anything else come from this? From the investigation? I know you've had a lot of, I was looking today, I think Boston Herald, I saw mentioned, a bunch of different newspapers outside of the area. Is there anything else to come from this?
We're actually talking to Mark Tatlow. He's the actual agent for Ghost Hunters.
We
actually got a contract sent from him. We're actually talking to him about signing a contract to do special events with Ghost Hunters and the different Mark with Zaffa and a couple other people. They're actually planning on doing a event at Aspen Manor. They're going to sell tickets up there to actually with the Ghost Hunters. I guess there are a couple of the other. I'm not positive which groups are coming in. But yeah, that's about it. And then, like I said, we've been flooded with phone calls and emails and all that. So
it's got to be pretty exciting.
Yeah, it is. It's really exciting. And like I told everybody, you know, I said even if they do come back, that there was nothing but animal bones, you know, that's still a big find. I mean, how many years have those actually been in that wall? And why were they in that
why
wall?
Are they in the wall? Because, listen, when we get these pictures put on the website, you're going to see they're not just like, hey, maybe a rat dragged them in and was chewing on them through the hole. You're going to look at them and be like, holy crap, why is that in the wall? You know, they were definitely placed there. So that's definitely, I mean, you're right. Whether or not it's a human, whether or not it's an animal, why is it in the wall?
Another thing is they found the glasses and stuff. And back when, like, back I know I've done some research. A lot of times, like, the mafia and that type people used to actually murder people and feed them to their hogs and feed them to their animals to get rid of the evidence.
Really?
Well, they did find human DNA. So, I mean, anything's possible. They may, you know, like I said, they may just be, you know, the animal bones, and it may be DNA from something else, maybe from the glasses or something like that. But like I said, it's still, you know, the way we look at it, it's a big find. I mean, these actually got sent to the Smithsonian, which was a big thing to do research. Like I said, too, the bones are very large, so if they are an animal, I don't think they're a chicken.
Maybe it ain't a chicken. You got four pictures? All right, Rick says we're getting four pictures to put on their neck. You're going to be able
ready and waiting.
All right, you're going to be able to see them on whispersradio.com here in just a little bit. You guys' website, what is it again?
www.brookcountyparanormal.com.
And you're still open. How far will you travel?
We like to try to stay in the area unless we're actually going somewhere. Like, you know what I mean? Brook County, Ohio, We've went to Kentucky, Virginia. My husband's family actually lives in Virginia, so we were down there, so we were in that area. But we like to try to stick, you know, close to this area, because we are Brook County Paranormal, so
yeah.
A lot of times we go out of town and they'll be like, Brook County Paranormal, where's that? Where are you from? You know,
yeah.
Brook County.
Well, Brook County. So if anybody can, they got all your contact info on your website?
Yeah, there's actually the phone number, the email. Actually, we have a chat on our actual website. You can actually chat. Usually, my husband's brother, who is our webmaster, Charlie, he usually is the one that's in there, and he'll answer questions, or if he can't answer, he gets in contact with us or gives him our phone number.
That's exactly how I found you. Charlie was there waiting.
Yeah,
I talked to Charlie for a while.
He is a wonderful person. I mean, he actually does our website for free.
That's good.
He keeps it up anytime we need anything, and he immediately changes it for us.
Thank you, Charlie. Guys, I want to thank you very much. Congratulations on your find, whatever it may be. Keep up the good work, my man. Keep it up. Don't falter to the ways of the Twilight Generation. If you need anything, go to their website. Contact them if you have any questions on what's going on. We are out of time. So, I would like, again, thank you guys very much for your time. Thank you for coming out.
Keep in contact with us.
Thank you definitely. For having us.
Nikki, who we got next week?
All right, we got Meg Blackburn Losey. She'll be talking about Indigo Children, the children of the now, I believe she calls them. And Bob Thiel will be talking about 2012.
Of course, because, you know, the movie came out. So, we got to have a 2012 show.
We got to see if we're all going to die.
And Indigo Children, for all of you that don't know out there, that's based on Aura. So, if you know anything about Aura, if you want to know anything about Aura, tune in, because it's going to be quite the shindig. That is all the time we got for today. So I want to thank everybody for listening. Until next week, don't be afraid, only believe. Dawn's light.